unto our enemies and fight against us, and so get them up out of the land. Therefore they did set over them taskmasters to afflict them with their burdens. And they built for Pharaoh treasure cities, Pithom and Ramses. But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew. They were grieved because of the children of Israel. Father, I thank you for your word. Thank you for the anointing that is upon your word. I ask you now, God, to anoint these lips of clay, that I may speak what thus saith the Lord to your people. And God, I ask you to help us all to open up our hearts and open up our minds. God, that we can receive from you what you would have for us to today. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. You may be seated if you'd like. I want to preach to you this morning on the topic, the multiplier effect. The multiplier effect. I can't look at our illustration this morning. It messes with my eyes. The multiplier effect. Thank you, Wesley. The multiplier effect. We know that Joseph was sold into slavery by his brothers, and he interpreted Pharaoh's dreams, and then he was promoted to second in command only to Pharaoh. And Joseph was sold into slavery and ended up becoming the second most powerful man in the world. And Joseph interpreted the dreams of Pharaoh, and thus Egypt was saved from a famine. And as a result of this, Joseph became second only to Pharaoh. So when all this happened, Joseph then moved his father and all of his house to Egypt so that he could make sure that they were cared for. This famine lasted for 7 years, and the only place that there was food was in the land of Egypt. And all the grain that they had collected during the 7 years of plenty, they were able to give back to the people during the 7 years of famine. So Joseph wanted to make sure that his family was cared for, so he brought them to live in Egypt with him. Now, and during this time, the children of Israel enjoyed blessings and favor due to Joseph's relationship with the king. But we pick up this story this morning where Joseph and all that generation had died, and a new king arose in Egypt that knew not Joseph. What was taking place here was a generational shift. A generation was arising who had not been around when Joseph helped save Egypt. There is a danger in trusting in past experiences to sustain you in the present. We've got to be careful inside the body of Christ that we don't just trust what happened to us in church 10 years ago to sustain us in the present. Amen. You may say, I shook the preacher's hand when I was 6 years old and everything's peachy king. I don't need to do anything else. There is a danger in trusting in that because you need a living, growing relationship with God, and you need to cultivate it and spend time with God every day, because if all you ever trust in is what used to happen in your life and all you ever trust in is what used to happen in God, it becomes very dangerous in the present. It's kind of like if you used to buy your wife flowers when you were dating. Oh, I'm going to meddle a little bit. If you used to buy your wife candy when you were dating, if you used to be all sweet, open the car door for her, and now you don't do any of that stuff, and you wonder why she's not all lovey-dovey like she used to be, and she's standing by the car door looking at you, and you're over there getting in the car going, what? That's a hint that she's waiting on you to open the door. Amen. Or when somebody else has flowers sitting on their desk at work and you come by and you want to get a hug and you hear, don't touch me. I'm meddling, I know. But it wouldn't be my preaching if I didn't meddle a little bit. So if you don't do those things and you trust, well, I bought you flowers 15 years ago. What is the big deal? I don't know what it is. I told my wife I would fix the bathroom out by our pool. And 5 years later, I finally got it done. And I told her, I said, I'm going to get it done. If I say I get it done, you don't have to remind me every 6 months. Y'all get that later. So if all we ever trust in our relationships with our spouse is what we used to do, how good do you think it's going to be now? So why do we think that we can have a relationship with God that we used to have and think that everything's going to be okay now if we don't ever cultivate that relationship? That's why a lot of times you think that you can just date God and blow kisses at God on Sundays and think everything's going to be all right all through the week. But then when all hell breaks loose on you during the week, you're like, God, I need you to help me. God, I need you to help me. And we don't want to blow kisses at God then. We want to get down to business with God. But we need to live our life in such a way that as soon as we begin to face difficulty, as soon as we begin to face problems, God's right there with us. He's always right there, but we shouldn't have to pray through every time we need God to do something for us. Lord, I know I hadn't been living right. God, I know I did this, and I hadn't repented of, but I need you right now. Amen. Let's move on. But there is a danger in trusting in past experiences to sustain you in the presence. You see, the children of Israel had enjoyed blessings and favor based on what Joseph had did, but they trusted in that too long. You see, as long as that generation was alive, it was okay to trust in relying on what Joseph did. But when that generation died, a new generation arose, a generation that knew not Joseph, a generation that was not concerned with past experiences. Just telling them what Joseph had done was not enough. They had not experienced what Joseph did for themselves, so they were not affected by the stories. You see, there comes a time when stories of what used to happen loses its appeal to a generation. They have to experience it firsthand for themselves. We must be careful as the body of Christ that we don't lose a generation because we tell them stories of what used to happen in the church. We live in a generation where the youth and the young people, young marrieds, have the information highway. And on their cell phones, they tote around a computer all day. Amen? They'll turn around and go home to get their cell phone if they leave it. They have it at their fingertips all the time. I think in another 20 years, the profession to be in is going to be chiropractic. Why? Because all these children's going to have neck problems. Why? Because they walk around like this all the time. Almost run into you walking down the street doing this. Move on. Are y'all okay this morning? Everybody wake up? All right. But they have the answers to everything they have right at the end of their hand. They can Google everything. You can Google anything. I like to mess with Siri all the time. I'll ask Siri some of the stupidest questions. And Siri will be like, let me get back to you on that. This is what I found. So anyway, it's just fun. But anyway, they have all this answers to their questions at the tip of their fingers. So we as a body of Christ are not going to win that generation if all we are doing is telling them what used to happen. They have to see it for themselves. They have to experience it for themselves. And if we are not careful, when we all go on to be with the Lord, if the Lord tarries, we will have Pentecostal churches without Pentecost. Woo. I refuse to allow my children to grow up and not experience Pentecost. I'm sorry. Why? Because there is not just so that they can know what it is to speak in tongues or to shout, but the power. Pentecost is power. Jesus said, you shall receive power after the Holy Spirit has come upon you. Amen. To do the works of God, to be the hands and feet of God. If you think all the Holy Ghost is just so you can speak in tongues and run around the church, you're sadly mistaken. It is power that you can do what God has called you to do. It's power to walk into a dark world and show them the light and the love of Jesus Christ. It is power to overcome whatever the devil throws at you. It's power to walk into a crack house or to walk into a hospital and walk in and say, in the name of Jesus, be free. In the name of Jesus Christ, be healed. That is where the power of Pentecost comes in. But if we're not careful, we'll lose a generation. We are losing young people left and right. The statistics are alarming at children who are raised in the church, but as soon as they get of age, they leave the church and don't come back. What are we missing? What are we doing? Because we get so busy telling them, oh, back in the day, God used to do this and God used to do this. And they're like, I want to see that for myself. I can't tell you how many times when I'm sharing some testimony with people and I'm sharing the things that I've seen God do, and the number one response I get is, I want to see that for myself. I want to experience that. We got to be careful that we don't just tell them what used to happen. This generation must experience firsthand the power of God. Now, during this generational shift, the enemy saw an opportunity. Why? The enemy always attacks at times of transition in your life. When you are making some changes in your life, when there's transition in your life is when the enemy comes in. Amen. When you decide, okay, I'm giving up the world and I'm going to start doing right, that's when the enemy attacks. That's why everything can be going all right, but as soon as you decide to start going to church and trying to start doing right, all hell breaks loose. Why? The enemy attacks at times of transition because he sees opportunities to get in there and pull you back from what you're trying to get rid of. You okay? Nod your head at me if you're okay. All right. So the enemy saw an opportunity. Egypt was a blessing to begin with. I know when we preach about Egypt all the time, we preach about bondage and hard times and all the things that they went through. Egypt was a blessing to begin with. But when you stay too long in one blessing, it becomes your bondage. The famine only lasted 7 years. The children of Israel spent 400 years there. After the 7 years was over, they were supposed to go home. I'm going to help you this morning, y'all, okay? Egypt was a blessing, but it became bondage when they stayed too long. Many times, people get hung up on an event where God really moved and they pitch camp and never move on. And thus, what was once their blessing becomes their bondage. You see, some places in our lives are just for a season. And we must be able to recognize this and move with God. Because if you get stuck in the same season for too long, that season can become your bondage. Amen. Seasons change in your lives. You know, if there's something in the natural, then there's a spiritual counterpart to it. What would happen if it was always winter around here? Some of you would freeze to death. Nothing would grow. The only good thing would be there'd be no mosquitoes. That's one creature God could have left off when he was doing creation. So if it was always winter, it would be all these times it'd be cold, it'd be this, you wouldn't enjoy a spring day or a fall evening and all these things. So seasons change to keep things in order. So in your life, seasons change. And if you end up marrying a season instead of being married to the God that controls the seasons, you're setting yourself up for failure. Don't marry the season. Marry the God who controls the seasons. Amen? That's why the Bible, we got to marry him because Jesus is coming back after what? A bride. So let's move on. And the children of Israel had this problem over and over and over. They were the bunch of stiff-necked, I'd hate to pastor that church. They were over 3 million of them come out of Egypt. 3 million. Moses' first church had 3 million in it. And they were a bunch of hardheads. I'm going to shake Moses' hand when I get to heaven and be like, you are the man. You are the man. Because I would have took that rod and beat the stew out of them. Even God got mad at them, wanted to kill them. God said, I'm going to wipe them off the face of the earth. And Moses got in God's face and said, you can't do that. They're your people. When Moses had to talk God out of killing them. I mean, God is God. His mercies are new and fresh every day. But these people got on God's nerves. I'm not preaching something Greek. It's in the book. God wanted to kill them. And these people, they were so hard-headed. Bread was falling out of heaven. Water was coming out of a rock. And if you actually study what happened, it says in the 40 years, their clothes did not wear out. Okay. How much does your body change in 6 months? All the ladies are like, these are my stretchy jeans. I seen a meme on Facebook yesterday. It said, around the holidays, what size pants do you wear? And it said, leggings. Yeah. So your bodies change and grow. But for 40 years, their clothes actually grew and shrunk with their bodies and did not wear out. Their shoes didn't wear out for 40 years. I mean, you got to understand all this stuff that was happening in these people's lives. But they continually moaned and complained. Bread's falling out of heaven. Well, we ain't got no meat. Water's coming out of a rock. Their clothes are growing on their body. A pillar of fire led them by night. A cloud led them by day. God was taking care of everything in their lives, but they continually bellyached. They continually complained. They continually had an issue. Oh, every time they had a problem, well, I wonder what's in the flesh pot in Egypt. Are there no graves in the wilderness that you brought us out here to die? What have you done to us, Moses? We want to go back here. So the children of Israel had this problem. And another problem they had was getting hung up on one thing over and over and over and over again. In Deuteronomy chapter 1, Moses is telling the people, said, remember when the Lord spoke to us at Mount Horeb and said, you've dwelt long enough at this mountain. Turn and take your journey. The children of Israel had seen wonderful things happen at Horeb. But God said, you've been here long enough. It's time to move forward. The children of Israel would experience something in God. They'd want to erect an altar and stay there forever. Don't get hung up on the way to your destiny. Because let me tell you something. Don't miss this today. The enemy will always offer you half on your way to whole. He will always offer you half on your way to whole. And most times we are content to accept half. We are content to accept just a little bit. You say, well, give me some scripture. I'm glad you asked. When God, Elijah, and Elisha was walking, and Elijah said, Elisha, I'm about to be taken. What can I do for you? He said, I want a double portion of your spirit. And Elijah said, you've asked a hard thing. Don't be scared to ask for hard things. We serve a God that can do anything. Don't be scared to ask God for hard things. Don't be afraid to believe God for hard things. And he says, you've asked a hard thing. Nevertheless, I love that word, nevertheless. Nevertheless means in spite of. In spite that you even asked a hard thing, if you see me when I'm taken, you'll have what you asked for. If you don't, you won't. In the original text, it says, if you see what I see when I'm taken. If you can see into the spirit what I see in the spirit when I'm taken, you'll have it. Watch this. So all of a sudden a chariot of fire comes down, parts them asunder, and Elijah's taken up into a chariot of fire, and Elisha saw it. That's what the scripture says. The Bible said Elijah's mantle fell, and Elisha picked it up, walked by, hit the mantle on the river. The river parted, and he walked over. But watch what happened. The sons of the prophets, which was like their spiritual sons, came to him and said, where is Elijah? Where is Elijah? And Elisha said, he's gone. And they said, let us go look for him. He said, I'm telling you, he's gone. There's no sense in looking for him. And they said, let us go look for him. To the point that Elisha finally got aggravated and said, go look for him. And they went and looked for him and looked and looked and looked. And they came back and said, we can't find him. And he said, I told you he was gone. But let me show you what happened right here. Elisha asked for a double portion. Are y'all with me? He did exactly twice the miracles that Elijah did. But when the sons of the prophets came, they had double standing in front of them. But but they were burning up to go look for half. How many times does God have what we need standing right in front of us, and we are burning up to go look for what we think we need? And we'll leave the double standing in front of us to go look for half. The enemy will always offer you half. Don't get hung up on half. If it's not everything God promised you, it's not the whole. Amen. If God promised you debt freedom, don't settle for we're finally just getting by. We're finally just scraping by. We finally our checking account's off life support. If you ain't had to spiritually shock your checking account, keep living. It'll happen. Amen. But there is a place in God where you don't have to do that no more. Hello? Show me in the book where you got to be broke to serve God. Show me in the book where you got to be sick to serve God. Show me in the book where you got to be crippled to serve God. Hello? If you read about these men in the Bible, Job was the greatest man in the East. And then God gave him double. He was a gazillionaire. Let me move on. The children of Israel were bad about getting hung up on one little thing. So God told him, said, you got to move on. Horam could have very easily become another Egypt for them. Why? Because God promised them a land flowing with milk and honey, and Horam was in the wilderness. Let me tell you something. Bread was falling out of heaven. Water was coming out of a rock. But can I tell you something? In the wilderness, manna's as good as it's going to get. Your bellies were not built for manna. What did God say? Your bellies were built for milk and honey. But so many people wandering around in the wilderness waiting on God to do this and God to do that. Manna's as good as it's going to get in the wilderness. I'm not preaching Greek this morning, am I? Y'all with me? Y'all quiet this morning. Let me move on. So the enemy saw an opportunity for their blessing to become their bondage. Pharaoh said to his people, watch this, the children of Israel are more and mightier than we are. In other words, the enemy recognized the children of Israel were greater than him. Watch this. The enemy knows that you are greater than him. Why? Because the enemy knows this book. How do you know the enemy knows this book? When he tempted Jesus all three times, he said, it is written. It is written. It is written. The enemy knows this book probably better than some of us, and that's why the enemy uses the book to deceive you and confuse you. Why? Because he knows it better than we do, and we're Christians professing to follow after Jesus, and the devil knows the Bible better than we do. Why it's so important to read your Bible. Why? Because even people that stand behind these pulpits can preach lies and deceits, and people think it's God. All because they holler and they go, ooh, thank you, Jesus, and they get all excited. We think it's anointed. Hello? If I preach something that you can't back up with the book, you call me on it. Hello? Know your word. So watch this. The enemy knows that you are greater than him. Why? Because what does the scripture say? Greater is he that is where? Than what? So the enemy knows that you are greater than he is. But he is scared to death for you to figure that out. We quote it, and it preaches good, and it shouts good, but do we really know it? There's a difference in speaking it and memorizing that verse and knowing it in your heart, knowing it in your mind. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. If you actually knew in your heart and in your mind that you are greater than what the enemy can do to you, you would not let him push you around the way he does. Hello? Because as long as you don't realize who you are, the enemy can keep you bound. So he sends things to afflict you, to keep your focus, your attention, instead of who you really are. Let me help you this morning. The problems and the afflictions that you face are to keep you distracted from figuring out who you really are. The reason so many people are just beat up by the devil and bruised up by the devil all the time is because they have no idea who they are. When you recognize that you are a daughter of the King, you are a son of the King, you won't let the devil push you around. You'll start thinking more about yourself. I'm a child of the King. I don't have to take this. I'm a child of God. I don't have to put up with this. When you begin to understand that in your life, I'm a child of God. I deserve better. Young men, if you're not married, I'm a man of God. I'm a son of the King. That makes me a prince. So I deserve a princess. Hello? Ladies, you're a daughter of the King. So you deserve a prince. Somebody that's going to treat you right. Somebody that's got some manners. A princess don't marry a hobo. Hello? Men, you're not going to find a princess in the club. A princess is not going to be walking around with her shirt cut down to here and her jeans so tight that she had to put some powder on to pull them up. I know that trick. Women, a prince ain't going to be walking around acting like a thug with his britches down around his knees and his underwear showing. Well, that's just the style. Well, have some respect and pull your britches up. If you wear a 28, don't go buy a 38. Trying to run from the police. Me and Michelle be watching cops or live PD, and their pants be around their ankles, and I'm like, watch them try to run. And they get like three steps. Bloop. I'm trying to help you this morning. You talking about, no, if you believe who you are in God, it changes your outlook on what you expect to receive from God. All right? If people are stricken in poverty, stricken in sickness, but you realize, I'm a child of the King. Jesus didn't take those 39 stripes on his back for nothing. He took them for my healing. And I refuse to accept sickness. I refuse to allow sickness to rule my body. I refuse to allow these sicknesses to, and in poverty, my God owns the cattle of 1,000 hills. He said that if I would pay my tithes and give in my offerings, that he would open up windows of heaven and pour out blessings on me that I don't have room enough to contain, and I refuse to accept poverty into my life. I don't mind telling you, we don't live from check to check at my house. I refuse to live like that. Why? Because I did what God told me to do. And I pay my tithes and I give my offering and I'm a good steward of what God's blessed me with, and we don't live from check to check at our house. And that's the way God wants us to live. Well, you just don't know how we're struggling financially. Are you paying your tithes? Well, we can't afford to pay tithes. Well, you can't afford to do much else either. Hello? Ooh, if looks could kill. People come to me, oh, you're a banker. Yeah, I'm a banker, and I'm a pastor. That's a bad combination. And the police. So I can arrest you, then come visit you in jail, and then loan you bail money. Got the whole market cornered there, you know. So, the enemy knows exactly, though, where to send the affliction in your life. That's why the Pharaoh said, come on, let us deal wisely, shrewdly with them. How many of you know the devil's not going to attack you where you're strong? The devil's not going to attack you where you're strong. I'm a person that I cannot stand the taste of alcohol. It makes me nauseous. I don't even like to smell it. And I get around people working with the police, and it's coming off them so bad, I'm about to get drunk just smelling their breath. Woo! And anyway, so the enemy knows not to tempt me with becoming a drunkard. Why? Because I don't like that. So the enemy's not going to come at you on somewhere that you're strong in your life. He's going to come at you and they know exactly what button to push. The enemy knows you may be strong right here, but if somebody pushes this button, it's on. And the devil knows which button to push in your life. He knows that he can't mess with you in some areas because you got this. I'm one that I can take all kind of stuff. You can talk about me, run me in the mud, I'm good. But if you mess with my woman or my kids, I turn my hat around backwards and be like, Jesus, do not come back in the next 10 minutes because I ain't going to make it. Lord, you said your grace would hold me, and grace better hold me because you better help them. Because you mess with my wife or my kids, it's home. That's my button. Don't push my button. Don't mess with my woman or my kids. So the enemy knows where to send stuff to push your buttons. He knows where to bring the attack. The enemy tells us then, though, he said he knows not to send it in certain areas, but he knows the areas you're most vulnerable. And you say, why does the enemy send this affliction? He tells us right here in this text. The enemy tells us why. He said, let's set taskmasters over them to afflict them, lest they multiply. Lest they multiply. Multiplication is growth at a multiplied rate. All right, let me test you this morning. What is 2 plus 5? Some people said, Okay. What is 2 plus 5? What is 2 times 5? You got the same numbers, but the addition in addition and multiplication. 2 plus 5 is 7. 2 times 5 is 10. So you can use the same amount, but at a multiplied rate, it grows quicker. The enemy said, we're going to afflict them to stop multiplication in their life. Are y'all with me? The enemy recognizes that we are greater than he are. He recognizes that the children of Israel were greater than him, but he definitely did not want them to grow anymore. You know, the devil, he's okay with us coming to church. Did you know that? He's okay with what goes on in this building. Why? Because we're not out in the world affecting his kingdom. Hello? People think just because I go to church, I'm wearing the devil out. What are you doing out in the street? What are you doing out in the street? I got a phone call the other day of a man that doesn't have any power at his house, and that it was going to be cold, and asked, could I help? Well, before revival service, me and Allie went to the store, and we bought a bunch of blankets and carried them to him, and I got outside and blowed the horn, beat on the door. Nobody had come to the door, and I went and just sat in the truck for about 5 minutes, and finally somebody started peering out the door. Gave him blankets, said, I just want to bless you with these blankets. Somebody told me, they said, don't you know he's a drug dealer? I said, I don't care. He don't deserve to be cold. Oh, come on now. Well, we got to begin to infiltrate the enemy's kingdom. The man looked at me like I was crazy and shook my hand. And I said, I just want to bless you. I tell you something, that is when the devil gets stirred up, when we start infiltrating his kingdom. When we start saying, I don't care what's on you, God loves you. I don't care what all you've done, God loves you. I don't care what you've been through, God loves you. God's got a plan for your life. And then we begin to infiltrate the enemy's kingdom, because we can sit here in this warm building with our padded pews, with our arms crossed, and people are dying and going to hell every day, and we go home and eat chicken and take a nap and pat ourselves on the back because we went to church. That's all. I'm going to just preach this morning. What are we doing to affect the enemy's kingdom? The enemy is scared to death of us working at a multiplied rate. What do you mean? When we go out and we share the gospel of Jesus Christ with somebody and it changes their life. Just like when Jesus sitting on the well with the town prostitute right by himself. He didn't have a witness to make sure he didn't say nothing out of line. Come on. If that had been a preacher today, we'd have talked about him and his ministry would have been ruined. I seen that preacher sitting there talking to that prostitute. Wonder what kind of deal he was trying to work out. I wonder if his wife knows. Y'all all nod your heads, but y'all all been saying the same thing. If y'all saw me in town talking to one of our town prostitutes, you'd be like, what is the preacher doing? Oh, I'm telling Michelle. Do you know that works? Yes, I know that happens. I took my sister to lunch, and somebody called my wife and said Ovid was in town with a blonde. That was my sister. Now, that may be okay in Kentucky, but not in South Mississippi. If you're watching from Kentucky, I'm sorry. Let me move on before I get in trouble. So the whole plan in the enemy sin and affliction is to prevent your multiplication. Why is the enemy so scared of that? Why is he so scared of our multiplication? He gives us this in our text as well. He said, when war falls out, they join together with our other enemies and fight us and get them up out of the land. What is he saying? The enemy fears a unified body of believers. Not black church, not white church, not Pentecostal church, not Baptist church, not Presbyterian church. Come on. God's people working together. Oh my gosh. We can't even have functions with other churches because they worried about stealing members. If somebody can steal your members, you never had them. Amen. Sorry, I got tickled by saying that. Inside joke. But anyway, when is all of God's people going to come together and work? When is God's people going to come together and say, it's not about building a big church. It's not about seeing who can have the nicest building or who can get the most people coming. It's about building the kingdom. It's about seeing people saved. It's about seeing people healed, seeing people delivered, seeing people set free by the power of Jesus Christ. That's what the enemy is afraid of. So what does he do? He sends all kind of junk to keep us all divided. We can't even hang out with some folks because they baptize different than we do. We can't even hang out with some folks because we dress different than they do. Hello? We can't even hang out with some folks because we wear sleeveless shirts. Oh, that used to be a big thing. Why? Because it causes people to lust. Let me tell you something. If you lust after that fatty part of your arm, something's wrong with you. They ain't nothing good looking about that. You need to be delivered from a demon of lust if that little flabby part of your arm in somebody's armpit turns you on. She just got the prettiest armpits I ever seen in my life. Is there something seriously wrong with you? Please come see me and we will counsel. And I'm going to smack you in the head and be like, what's wrong with you? I can see now a new video, a new magazine coming out of armpits. Man, like, oh, I got to have that one. Let me move on. The enemy's scared to death of all of God's people getting together. But can I tell you something? If we can't get together over here, how are we going to get together up there? That's why we sing songs, and I think it was bad theology, and I'm probably fitting to get in trouble for saying this. We used to sing a song that says, everybody will be happy over there. So what it's going to do, be miserable while you're here? Or when we all get to heaven, when we all get together over there? Why? Because we can't get together down here. So we sing songs to celebrate it all working out once we get to heaven, but what are we doing to work it out while we're here? Sunday is still the most segregated day in the United States. It should not be like that. It's God's church, God's people. Hello, if you cut me, I'm going to bleed red. If you cut UT, she's going to bleed red. You cut anybody in here, they're going to bleed red, no matter what's on the outside. Hello? Let me move on. Then lost all my amens. He wants us to keep fighting amongst ourselves and have division between denominations so that we all can't come together and fight against Him. Because He knows if that happens, we could move forward and do great exploits. You know that if all of God's people would get together, we could control the outcome of every election. Oh, y'all ain't listening. There comes a time when you got to throw Democrat and Republican to the side. Well, I've always voted Democrat. Well, I've always voted Republican. Well, I've always voted. Stop voting party and start voting what God lays on your heart and start voting your conscience. Hello? Just because you white don't mean you have to vote Republican. Just because you black don't mean you have to vote Democrat. You need to vote what God lays on your heart and pray, research the candidates, and see what you put in your seal of approval on. Because if that joker says, I support this and this and this, and you put your name on it, you're saying, I support what you support. I don't care what the party they run for. Hello. Stop being caught up in the hype and keeping everybody divided. And we vote our conservative beliefs. If you're a Christian, you're a conservative. Hello. If you are a Christian, you are conservative. Why? Because we believe in marriage and we believe in life. Hello. I hope you know you're conservative. I hope you are conservative if you're a child of God, because the Bible is conservative, and we believe the Bible. Oh, Lord. Now, I'm bringing it down to a close. The enemy knows that multiplication will produce freedom from bondage, freedom from things that have kept the body of Christ bound for so long. I'm fixing to show you how this works. Too long has the body of Christ been bound by poverty. So many of our people are born again, on their way to heaven, but they're so bound by poverty. They're so bound, they can't even hardly take care of themselves, much less do ministry. Somebody come and ask them for $5, and you'd be like, I wish I had $5. Come on. People are bound by poverty. People are bound by lack, bound by addiction. Bound by sickness, bound by brokenness, bound by depression, bound by their past. So many people are bound up in the body of Christ, and the enemy is scared to death for us to get free. Because what happens? Back to the story. Jesus talking to the woman at the well. She goes back to the city and says, come see a man that told me everything I ever did. In other words, come, let me introduce you to somebody that has changed my life. You want to know how multiplication happens? We start going into the world and introducing them to Jesus. And when they get set free, there ain't no denying that God got a hold of them. And they say, let me tell you about the Jesus that changed my life. And they go back into the crack houses. They go back into to wherever. And they say, let me tell you about a Jesus that changed my life. And the Bible says many people believed because of what had happened in her life. There is a harvest out there. But it's in places that normally you don't want to go. It's around people you don't want to fool with. I tell people all the time, when I put somebody in the back of a police car, I've got a captive audience. They're in handcuffs in the back of a police car. They're not getting out. They are captive. God, y'all are SLOW this morning. Just kidding, guys. That spells slow. I've got a captive audience, and I start sharing Jesus with them. Do they want to hear it? Sometimes they don't, but they go, where are they going? And I start telling people, you know Jesus loves you. I know I got to make a change if you just let me go. No, you're still going to jail, but Jesus loves you. It don't work like that. You is drunk, you're still going to jail. But God loves you. And I'm going to be praying for you. He's got a plan for your life. Let me tell you something. You never know what that little bit of encouragement to somebody. Instead of saying, oh, you're nothing but a drunk. You're nothing but a drug addict. Looking at them and seeing past all that and saying, hey, you know Jesus died for you. Just like he died for me. Let me tell you something. That means the world to people. And we have people that go to this church now, faithfully, that I've had in handcuffs before. And we've shared Jesus with them. Tell you something, it works. God can change lives. God can turn their lives around. So the Bible says that they built treasure cities, Pithom and Ramses. Watch this. Sister Beverly, would you come? They built treasure cities for Pharaoh, Pithom and Ramses. In other words, God's people are burdened. God's people are enslaved, and they are building treasure cities for the enemy. How does that work today? God's people are so burdened, and the enemy's kingdom's flourishing. You can't pay your rent, and the drug dealer's riding around in an Escalade, living in a mansion. Hello? You can't even buy your kids' school clothes, and the pornography industry is making billions. It's the truth. You might as well nod like this, because it don't change the truth. God's people bound up in all this, and the enemy's kingdom is flourishing. While God's people are being bound, the enemy's building treasure cities. Treasure cities. And God's people are helping finance it. God's people are helping build it. God's people enslaved were helping build the enemy's kingdom, treasure cities. That's why some people, instead of going to God, they call 1-800-MISS-CLEO. Paying $9.99 a minute for some witch to try to tell you your future. The Bible calls them soothsayers. It's a witchcraft spirit. Hello? God's people flogging to that. God's people bound by addiction, funding the pornography industry. Hello? God's people bound up by poverty, funding these get-rich-quick schemes, wiring thousands of dollars overseas for get-rich-quick schemes. Hello? Funding the enemy's kingdom. They built treasure cities for the enemy. We're seeing this happen today. Christian businesses being sued for standing for their morals. The enemy's using the same plan today that he used against the children of Israel. See, you got to understand something about the enemy. He does not have the power to create. So he can never show you something authentic. He's going to use the same old, tired old stuff over and over. But guess what? It keeps working. He can't show you something new because he does not have the power to create. So he's going to use the same old junk over and over and over. That's why many of us keep facing the same thing over and over and over again. But it was working. But watch this. Scripture says the enemy's plan backfired. It said the more he afflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew. The affliction didn't have the desired results. You know, affliction's going to come, but you can make it not have the desired result the enemy wants it to have. Somebody comes along and hurts you. Instead of hurting them back, you pray for them. Watch what happens. It don't have the desired effect. when something comes in your life, between your marriage, between your children, and it could destroy you, you turn around and you hold on to the promises of God. You don't let it have that desired effect. The more he afflicted them, the more they multiplied. In other words, every time the enemy tries to do something to you, turn it around on him. Just like Joseph told his brothers. He said, you meant this to destroy me, but God turned it around and blessed me with it. Hey, whatever the enemy throws at you, turn it around and let God bless you with it. Whatever the enemy throws, turn it around and let God bless you with it. Sorry, y'all, I'm sweating down. Whatever he throws at you, let God bless you with it. Let God turn it around. Turn that affliction into multiplication. Well, how do I do that, preacher? Don't let it make you bitter. Let it make you better. Don't let it destroy you. Let it make you better. When the enemy sends everything he can into your life to destroy you, turn it around and don't let it have that desired effect. Yes, she left you. Yes, she hurt you. But instead of letting it make you bitter, let it make you better. And say, I'm a prince. I deserve a princess. Because if they were trashy enough to hurt you, don't let them continue to control you. If they left you, it may have left you broken for a while, but guess what? God puts us back together, and it makes us better. Because the enemy can't destroy you, because if he could, he would have already done it. And the things that the enemy sent in my life, I'll talk about me. The things the enemy sent in my life to destroy me, I could very easily be wallowing in it. But I said, I choose life. And I choose to grow out of the dirt that they left me in. I choose to grow out of what I went through. I choose to grow out of my brokenness. I choose to let it make me better. Hey, I was wounded. Y'all know me, I'm very transparent. I was wounded to the point I didn't think I could go on. And some of you that have known me for a while knew that I went through a very difficult time in my life. I was broken. I was betrayed. Friends walked away from me. 10 years later, people still don't talk to me. That's okay. I'm actually all right with that. But instead of sitting there and wallowing and letting it destroy my life, I said, God, put me back together. God, here's all the pieces of my heart. God, here's all the pieces of my life. It's in shambles. God, put it back together. And guess what? I love to rub it in the devil's face that I'm back and I'm stronger than ever in God. And guess what? God's did that for many of you. That I'm back and I'm stronger than ever. And I see people today and that don't know my story and don't know my testimony. And they say, well, I would have never thought you'd have went through that. Guess what? When God puts you back together, people can't even look at you and tell you went through anything. How do you know that? Because when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out of the burning fiery furnace, the Bible said not a hair on their head was singed and their clothes didn't even smell like smoke. You couldn't even tell they had been through anything in their life because of what God does. The multiplier effect. Turn your affliction and let it make you better. Let it make you grow. Whew. Don't let it have the desired effect. You're in control of that. Do you know that? That you're in control of what you allow to affect you and how you allow it to affect you. You're in complete control of that. Somebody comes along and hurts your feelings. You can't control that. But you can control how you react to it. You can either give them the fivefold ministry. There's five and you fold them. You can either give them the fivefold ministry or you can pray for them. And you can look at them and say, God bless you. And then you get to go up to them in Walmart every time you see them and make them speak to you. How you doing? You must be in a hurry because I seen you running around that curve. Was you trying to get away from me? If you don't do that, start doing it. It's fun. Would you stand with me all over the house? It's okay to have a good time in God's house. Amen. Job was afflicted so bad. Didn't do anything wrong. Job was a man that had seemingly everything. God asked Satan, said, have you considered my servant Job? The devil said, yeah, but you got such a shield around him, I can't get to him. God said, I'll take it all down, but you can do anything you want to him, but you can't kill him. As you know the story, Job went through. All of his children died. All of his servants died. He lost all his money. He went bankrupt. And he was a very wealthy man. Then his body began to be attacked. And I've said this before, but some of you may not have heard this. His body began to be attacked, and he had sores come up on his body. And these sores got infected and got maggots in them. And Job would sit around with broken pieces of pottery and scrape maggots out of his skin. And the only time he got any relief is when dogs would come by and lick his sores. And here is Job sitting in this mess, naked, sitting in a pile of ashes, scraping maggots out of his skin. Even his wife saying, "Job, curse God and die, man. It can't get no worse." And Job looks up into heaven and says, "Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him." Job said, "I refuse to let this affliction have the desired effect." And God brought Job out of that, and he lived 120 years after that with double everything he had lost. When we preach about Job, we preach about his affliction. That only lasted about 9 months, but he lived 120 years in double. Wow. Some of you may have been through rough times, maybe afflicted right now. I want to tell you something. Don't let it have its desired effect. Turn that affliction into multiplication. Would you bow your heads? Father, I have delivered my heart today.